ألف لام ميم. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم، نزل عليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه وأنزل التوراة والإنجيل من قبل هدى للناس وأنزل الفرقان. إن الذين كفروا بآيات الله لهم عذاب شديد، والله عزيز ذو انتقام. إن الله لا يخفى عليه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وحده، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his household, his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them and grant them all goodness, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us such a blessed month whereby we come every single night for the entire month and we listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And above that, we take home a message that we can ponder over and we can study, we can implement in our own lives and convey it to others. So thank Allah for giving us season after season for rejuvenating and refreshing our spirituality and for granting us closeness to Him. May He still grant us even more closeness to Him as the days pass, in such a way that the day we leave this world, we will be the closest we ever were to our own Maker. May He forgive us on that day, and may He grant us ease. Beloved brothers and sisters, we were looking at how the kuffar of Quraysh, the disbelievers in Quraysh, had boycotted the Muslims. And I had made mention of several points. They said, we will not marry into them, nor will we allow them to marry into us. We will not deal with them, nor will we allow them to deal with us. We will not provide them any sustenance, anything at all that is of goodness for them. We're not going to sign a treaty with them, nor will we allow them to initiate that. And we are not going to mix with them, nor will we allow them to mix with us. We will not even sit with them, and we will not even talk to them, and we won't even allow them to enter our houses. These were some of the points that were written down and described for your information. The man who was writing it down, his name was Mansur ibn Ikrimah. According to some of the narrations, later on, he actually became paralyzed on his hand. He couldn't write after that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Remember one thing. When a person harms the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wallahi, there is very little hope for them, because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who will retaliate instead of that particular person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and grant us goodness. So they had written this and they had managed to get the Muslims into a place known as Shi'ab Abi Talib on the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah. And for 3 years, the Muslims suffered. As we made mention of last night, they began to eat the leaves of the trees and they were sucking on the roots of some of the shrubs in order to extract the water from there, the liquid from it. And they were roasting the skins, meaning the hide of the animals that they had already cut, and trying to nibble on it in order to get whatever goodness was there. They became frail, they became sick, they became very, very weak, and so on. It did not deter them, not at all, not at all. With us, imagine for 3 years, if we had to be boycotted completely, no food, no drink, I think 3 days later, we probably would give in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. The reason I make mention of this is because we are spoiled, and still we don't understand the gift of Allah. We have 3 meals a day. And a lot of the times we have much more than we can actually eat. Take a look at the month of Ramadan. Today, on our tables in the evening, when we were opening the fast, didn't we have much more than we could consume? Allahu Akbar. That's a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us conscious of His gifts. What had happened then, because it was becoming very difficult, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told his companions they may go to Habasha or to Abyssinia. Once again, we made mention of this in a little bit of detail yesterday, and we said that there were 83 men and 18 women who left for Abyssinia at the time, and Ja'far ibn Abi Talib was the Amir of them. And Quraysh did not stop there. They sent Amr ibn al-As with a team of people to go to Najashi, the Negus of Abyssinia. And as we heard yesterday, he went and he told the Negus that there are a group of people here from the people of Mecca, from our people, who have reneged from the religion of our forefathers, and they are wanted back in Mecca, and they are criminals and so on. They have come to your land to seek asylum, send them back. And these people had come with gifts to give the king, you know, to give this leader of Abyssinia. And after some time, this leader, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had already told the Muslims he would be just. He's a Christian man. He will listen to you. He will not oppress you. So he had asked Ja'far ibn Abi Talib what he had to say. And after making it very clear as to why they were there and as to the ignorance they were in before and how they were blessed by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being sent to them with the highest level of character and conduct and the highest level of worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to be worshipped alone. No sticks, no stones, no idols, no people, nothing besides Allah, besides the Maker, besides the one that we will return to. So in Najashi, then he allowed them to stay and he told the people of Mecca to leave. The Quraysh, Amr ibn al-As, was told to leave. And guess what? He was given back all the gifts to say, take all this away and carry on. Because I didn't do what you wanted me to do here. It's like you came to me with a bribe. Take it back, go away. Allahu Akbar. Today when people take bribes, Allah safeguard us. Even if they don't do your work for you, the bribe is eaten. Allahu Akbar. It's gone. May Allah safeguard us. Look at the honesty of the man. Because they did not get what they wanted, he gave everything back. He says, take this and carry on. That was a just ruler, the ruler of Abyssinia. Allahu Akbar. So they slept the night and they thought of a plan. We mentioned this yesterday, I'm repeating it today. They came back and said, do you know what, O Negus of Abyssinia? These people blaspheme Jesus Christ. Do you know what? They say something very bad about Jesus. May peace be upon him. So he called Ja'far ibn Abi Talib and the Muslims and said, what do you people say about Jesus? So Ja'far ibn Abi Talib said, عبدالله ورسوله كلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه. He is the worshipper of Allah, the slave of Allah, the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ruh, his soul was blown into the Virgin Mary, born without a father, miraculously. That's what we believe, and so on. And he mentioned whatever he was taught about Isa, the Prophet Jesus, may peace be upon him. And subhanallah, what did Najashi do? When he heard that, he said immediately, that is exactly what we know about the Prophet Jesus, may peace be upon him. It's exactly what we know. Imagine, this was the authentic teachings of Christianity coming from Africa. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So he asked Ja'far ibn Abi Talib to read some of the Quran. And as we heard yesterday, he read the verses, opening verses of the surah named after Mary, the Virgin Mary, may peace be upon her, the mother of Jesus Christ, may peace be upon him. كافها يا عين صاد ذكر رحمة ربك عبده زكريا إذ نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال رب إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا ولم أكن بدعائك رب شقيا. The story starts of Zakaria alayhi salatu wassalam and how he made a dua in old age that, oh Allah, I'm not going to lose hope in your mercy, grant me male offspring. And how then he had children and then Mary had a child as well and so on. And the entire story of Isa alayhi salatu wassalam is mentioned, but the opening verses were enough to make the tears of Najashi roll down his eyes. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, revelation revealed to him that An-Najashi and his men were crying when they heard the Quran, and The Quran says that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although the Najashi, having accepted Islam, did not inform his subjects of it and his people of it. He kept it within. Later on, in the year 9 Hijri, according to some of the narrations, and some say the 8th of Hijrah, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reports in a hadith, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said one day that I have been informed that Najashi, your brother, Ashama, that was his name, was Ashama, and Najashi is just the title. It's like a king. So Ashama and Najashi of Abyssinia has passed away, your brother. Let us get up and read Salatul Janaza for him. And so they got up in absentia and they read Salatul Janaza for An-Najashi. And that was evidence enough to prove that he was a Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, and may he take us away in a condition of Iman. So these people, Amr ibn al-As went away. For your information, just something very interesting. Amr ibn al-As, he came back to Abyssinia sometime later in order to try his tricks. Sometime later he came back and he spoke to the Najashi once again, and Najashi told him a few words, and it is reported that that is when Islam entered the heart of Amr ibn al-As. Islam entered the heart of Amr ibn al-As, which means within his heart he already began to accept, because he heard someone from Africa confirm that that is a Nabi. In fact, exactly what happened was he was told that the angel that came to Jesus and Moses is the same angel that has come to the man you are talking about, which is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was witnessed by a man who lived very, very far away, who did not even see An-Najashi. Who did not even see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, some make mention of the fact that later on he went to Medina Munawwara and accepted in the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was Amr ibn al-As. But those who have made mention of the fact that he accepted Islam with An-Najashi, there is something interesting. If that was the case, then it's the first time that a Sahabi accepted Islam at the hands of a Tabi'i. Have we thought of that? Because Najashi was a Tabi'i. He did not see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if the narration is valid, then this would have been the case. However, the more common narration is that he came back and later on he spoke to Khalid ibn al-Walid, and just before the victory of Makkah, they had come in to Medina Munawwara and accepted Islam with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So at that particular time, whilst the Muslims were being surrounded and they were boycotted and so on, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was suffering so much suffering. Why? Because no one speaking, no one dealing, nothing happening. He decided, Allah has given me permission to go to Abyssinia, let me go. So on his way out, as he is progressing, going to Abyssinia, he meets a man who knew him. His name was Ibn al-Dughunnah. This Ibn al-Dughunnah stops him. Ya Abu Bakr, where are you going? He says, I am now leaving my people. They are troubling us. They are not allowing us to follow and fulfill what we believe. So now I am going to Habasha. Perhaps Allah will open our doors there and so on. He says, no, a man like you should not be going. You are an honorable man. You fulfill the rights of everyone. Your character and conduct is exemplary. You help the widows and the orphans, and you assist those in need. You do not lie and so on. Come with me. I will take you back to Quraysh and give them my guarantee that they will not harm you. And they should not harm you, from my guarantee. So he went back with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and he spoke to the leaders of Quraysh, who agreed on one condition. They said, this man must not worship Allah openly, and he must not recite the Quran openly, because we've got rid of all of them. They are all somewhere in Shi'ab Abi Talib, and this man here is going to come and he's going to read the Quran aloud. Our daughters, our sons, our children, everyone is interested. They are already turning towards these words, and we don't want these words to be uttered again. We've just managed to solve the problem. For your information, if you look at the list of names of Muslims, all these top chiefs, their children were involved. They were already Muslim. All the big boys, Allahu Akbar. Their children were already Muslim and members of their family, either brothers, sisters, somehow relatives, very close relatives, were all already within the fold of Islam. So they knew that something drastic has to happen to block it, otherwise we are dead. What was the problem? Why were they so worried? They were worried because they feared loss of power. They feared loss of wealth. They thought some authority is going to come above us and going to take us over. And then we will lose all our dignity. They did not know Islam gives dignity. It does not take it away. Allahu Akbar. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was free. And later on, he in the house, he used to read salah outside in the little courtyard of his. And people started flocking again. These people called Ibn al-Dughunna after some time and told him, look, this man is breaking the promise. So Ibn al-Dughunna came to him and told him, look, I gave you my guarantee. And I gave the same guarantee to the people of Quraysh about you. And now you are breaking the promise by reading the Quran outside. Everybody is coming to listen to it. And people are coming, they don't want that. So either you stop it or I take back my guarantee. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, what do you think he said? He said, take back your guarantee. Go back to them and tell them this I can't manage. So he went back, he took the guarantee. That is when they started harming Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Even physically, the people of Quraysh began to usurp wealth because they had got the Muslims into Shi'ab Abi Talib. So now their wealth was open. They began to usurp things and oppress in a huge way. Until one day, there was a group of people who saw, in fact, one man, and his name was Hisham ibn Amr. He was from Quraysh, not a believer. And he saw his relatives suffering because Banu al-Muttalib and Banu Hashim were in Shi'ab Abi Talib being surrounded, boycotted, suffering, dying, and so on. And he says, this Hisham ibn Amr, he says to himself, we can't allow this to happen. Let me think of a plan. These are our brothers and sisters, our blood, our real family. How can this happen? He thought to himself, Abu Jahl, who is the one who came up with the idea of boycott, had we come up with the idea of boycott about his family, he wouldn't have followed us. So why must we follow him? Look at this man, not a Muslim. This is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُؤَيِّدُ هَذَا الدِّينِ بِالرَّجُلِ الْفَاجِرِ. That at times Allah grants or gives support and strength to the deen by a man who is sinful, sometimes by a man who's not even a Muslim. The example of Abu Talib is cited, the example of this young man. What did he do? He went to one of his friends, Zuhair ibn Abi Umayyah, and he says exactly what he thought, that look at these people, they are dying. We need to break this treaty. I'm ready to break it, this little covenant. I feel like going to the Kaaba and tearing it, ripping it to pieces in front of everyone, but I need one man to support me. So this man says, I'm with you. So now he went to a third man, and the third man was Al-Mut'im ibn Adi. And he told Mut'im ibn Adi the same thing. I need a man's support to do this. I want to tear it, rip it apart. Aren't you feeling compassionate against, towards these people here? Don't you feel in your heart a little bit of mercy? He says, yes. So he says, okay, that makes now three of us. Allahu Akbar. And he went to another one, a fourth one. The fourth one was Abu al-Bakhtari ibn Hisham. And he tells him the same thing. Abu al-Bakhtari says, I'm with you. He says, now that makes four of us. Allahu Akbar. And he went to a fifth one. Look at this man and his tactic of thinking. If he were to announce it, it wouldn't have succeeded. But one by one, he went to those whom he trusts and he spoke to them on humanitarian grounds. Subhanallah. Humanitarian grounds. He says, look, we need to break this. This is barbaric. How can you prevent people from eating? How can you prevent people from food and drink and they are your blood? How? So now they went to the final man, Zam'ah ibn al-Aswad, and the five of them agreed. So Zuhair ibn Abi Umayyah says, let's go to the Kaaba, and we pretend like we are not connected, and I will stand up in front of Abu Jahl and the others, and I am going to announce that this is oppression against Banu Hashim and Banu al-Muttalib, and I am going to get up and tear and rip this covenant which is on the Kaaba, and from today on it's going to be broken. And when I say that, let's see what happens. You all come in one by one to support. So this was happening on one front. On the other front, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 3 years have gone by. We want to let you know that the ants, the termites, have eaten the covenant. Nothing is left of it besides where the name of Allah was written.
So it's eaten up. In the Kaaba, it's in the Kaaba, but it's eaten up. The termite, the mite has eaten it. So he tells his uncle, "Oh, my uncle, this is what has happened." The uncle says, "Are you sure?" He says, "Allah has told me. Allah has told me. That's a guarantee. It's not wrong." So Abu Talib is now in the vicinity of the Kaaba preparing to tell these people. And in the meantime, this man gets up. Now, these are two narrations. We've brought them together. So this man, Zuhair ibn Abi Umayyah, he gets up and he makes his announcement. "We want to break the covenant. I'm going to do this and do that." And Abu Jahl gets up and says, "You dare touch it?" So now Hisham ibn Amr gets up and says, "What are you talking about? I agree with this man here. It is wrong, it is oppressive," and so on. So Abu Jahl says, "Who you think you are?" And the third one gets up and says, "No, I also agree with these two. What they are saying is right." And then a few people get in, and the fourth one comes, and the fifth one comes. And then Abu Talib says, "Hang on. This covenant has been eaten by ants, and this was information given to my nephew by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." And everyone is silent. They are silent. What is the silence? The covenant is eaten. So Quraysh get together quickly and they tell Abu Talib, "Okay, what if the covenant is not eaten?" He says, "If the covenant is not eaten, I hand you my nephew. I give him to you." That's all they wanted. They wanted him to execute him. "I hand him to you. And if the covenant is eaten, the boycott stops immediately." They agreed and they struck that agreement properly. And then they look into the Kaaba. They see, lo and behold, it is completely eaten besides the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these young boys were successful, and at the same time the revelation that had come to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam as well was completely accurate, subhanallah. Still, the boycott, mashallah, it had stopped immediately, but they didn't believe. And what is of irony is Abu Talib himself also did not believe yet. That's very ironic. And this goes to show that sometimes when Allah has not written guidance for someone, it will never come. It's our teaching. We are taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to constantly say, "Allahumma ya muqallib al qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik." Oh Allah, oh Allah, who turns the hearts, the one who owns the turning of the hearts, turn our hearts upon the right path, not away from it. Because Allah owns the hearts. We say, "Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim," guide us to the straight path, because guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah seals the hearts, who is going to guide those hearts thereafter? So may Allah open our doors. Some people see the light, they see it bright, shining, but they don't want to take heed and they don't want to learn lesson. So this was revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and these boys, subhanallah, these youngsters of Quraysh, they had succeeded. And the boycott was over. And now the people of Quraysh began to persecute the Muslims once again. A very, very great degree. And what had happened at that particular point, Allah blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a blessing. The people of Najran, Najran was a distance from Makkah al-Mukarramah. They were predominantly Christian people. They had heard about this messenger and they decided to send a group of people, mashallah, to go and see this man and to get news and to see whether he is right or wrong. So the Christians of Najran sent 20 men to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when they had come out of the boycott. And they came and asked him questions. And they asked him, they heard some of the Quran, asking him questions. All 20 accepted Islam. One go. Allahu Akbar. They all accepted. Look, the people of Quraysh did not accept, but people from far away came and accepted. This is what happens to the Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their own people boot them out. This is what Waraqa bin Nawfal said. When you come with this message to your people, they're not going to listen to you. But the others further away will benefit from it much, much more than your own people. May Allah grant us really a lesson. I always like to make mention of the ulama of your area. Every time there are ulama in your midst, make use of them. If you don't make use of them, there will be others further away who will be making use of them, and you will go without any form of goodness, without having benefited. When you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will ask you, "I kept so and so and so and so right near you as your neighbors. How did you not benefit from them? They had the message, you didn't even get the message." So ensure that you make use of the ulama in your midst. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May Allah open our doors. The lesson we have just learnt is from what happened. The people of Najran came. What about the people of Makkah? His own family rejected. Allahu Akbar. His own uncle and the others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not prohibit us. So Abu Jahl looks at these people of Najran and he says, you people are mad. How can you have come here, ask one, two questions and you accept when we live here and we know this man and we will never accept. So immediately Allahu Akbar, they responded. They said, look, we have our choice, we have chosen. You have your choice, you've chosen. And you know what? We don't want to debate with someone who's a fool. And Allah revealed verses to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا اللَّغْوَ أَعْرَضُوا عَنْهُ وَقَالُوا لَنَا أَعْمَالُنَا وَلَكُمْ أَعْمَالُكُمْ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ لَا نَبْتَغِي الْجَاهِلِينَ.
When they hear the foolish person, when they hear that which is vain, what Abu Jahl was saying, when they hear that which is vain, they turned away from it. They turned away from it. And they said, we have our deeds, our choice, you have your deeds, your choice, and peace be upon you. We are not going to waste our time debating and arguing with you. So this verse was revealed in connection with the group that had come from Najran and what debate or what little discussion they had had with Abu Jahl. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us lesson. Then Allahu Akbar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of something very, very powerful connected to something that had happened that was very sad on one hand, and the other hand, a lesson for all. The uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fell ill. He fell sick. And Quraysh, they were happy and they were sad. They were happy and they were sad. They were sad thinking this man is going to accept Islam last minute. And they were happy because they thought to themselves, once he's gone, we can nail this man as we like. Allahu Akbar, may Allah protect us. This nephew, he was being protected by the uncle. The uncle dies, we can do whatever we want with this nephew. So they made sure they were around Abu Talib on his deathbed. He was now very old and sickly. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, who loved his uncle a lot, meaning he had great care for his uncle cared for him. But when Islam came, he continued trying to convey the message of Islam to his uncle. His uncle knew what was right and wrong, but he had not uttered the shahada. He didn't declare it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us not only the utterance of shahada, but the belief and the ability to convey it to others. Ameen. So his uncle, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, looks at him and says, Ya Am, قُلْ كَلِمَةً أُحَاجُّ لَكَ بِهَا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. I want you to utter one statement so that I can fight your case on the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. You utter one statement and the rest is mine, so to speak. Say one word, I will bear witness on the day of Qiyamah that you have uttered it. Just say that there is none worthy of worship besides the Maker and the one you are going to return to. Just say that. Once you utter that, I will do the rest for you. Allahu Akbar. Because you need to turn away from the idols and all what Quraysh was worshipping, and you need to come to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the uncle, he actually tells his nephew, oh my nephew, had it not been for these big boys around me, meaning the big people of Quraysh around me, I would have made you so happy by that statement. But if I now say it on my deathbed, it's going to be a great embarrassment. I will go down as a traitor in history. Look at this. This is what the man says. If it wasn't for Quraysh around here, I would be uttering. And Quraysh was waiting, meaning the heads, they were waiting there because they knew we don't want tomorrow to hear that on his deathbed he became a Muslim and we didn't know. So we want to bear witness, we are going to be right here. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very sad because he kept repeating this, that oh my uncle, utter one statement, just say la ilaha illallah and I will bear witness for you, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the uncle passed away. When the uncle passed away without having uttered these words, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very, very sad. Very, very sad. And this is when verses were revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ.
You do not guide whomsoever you wish, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We guide, Allah guides whomsoever He wishes. Subhanallah. So guidance is not in your hands. Guidance is in the hands of Allah. In your hands is to show the path. Whether they walk on it or not is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, hidayah is divided into two categories. Like Allah says, wa innaka latahdi ila siratin mustaqim. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you guide them to the straight path, which means you show them where the path is. But the guidance, as in the ability to walk on that path, that's only in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's not confuse the two types of guidance. One is al-dalala wal-irshad. The other one is tawfiq, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives acceptance to a person to walk on the path. A lot of us know what is right and wrong, but a lot of us are guilty of slipping here and there and doing that which is wrong and not doing that which we are supposed to. So this happens. May Allah forgive us and make us strong. So to know what's right and wrong is one thing, but to walk on that path is another thing. So this was also a verse that was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now there was a very, very difficult time that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had gone through. Very difficult, because his uncle passed away. The people of Quraysh began, they already threatened, now we're going to kill this man. And do you know, Abu Talib was the external support, which means he protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from any external harm by the will of Allah. But something else happened. Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, who was the closest to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his own wife, who was the biggest pillar of support and comfort, she also fell ill and passed away. Khadija radiallahu anha. This was in the 10th year of Hijrah. It became known as the year of sadness, because one after the other negativities came into place, what we would term negativities. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, although he was sad, he knew Allah's plan. He was a Nabi and he knew there is a plan. He knew that these words and this message have to go across wherever there are human beings, wherever there are mankind or jinnkind, the message is definitely going to reach. He lost his uncle, he lost his wife. The uncle, as I said, protected him from external harm. The wife protected him internally, comforted him. So he lost that inner comfort and the outer comfort zone that he had had all along. This was a test. Now he thought to himself, subhanallah, the people of Quraysh, they're planning to kill me. They want to kick me out. They want to boycott. They want to surround. They want to persecute. They want to do so many things. Allah makes mention in the Quran, وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِيُثْبِتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهِ. These kuffar, they were planning to keep you on one spot, which means to ground you, number one, or to kill you, or to expel you. They were planning, Allah plans, and Allah is the best of planners. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought to himself, you see, the people of Taif, they are the closest people. It's the next city, closest to Makkatul Mukarramah, not too far. Let me go there and perhaps I will try with them. If I win their support, perhaps we could come into Quraysh and explain to them, and perhaps they would then, seeing how many people of Taif have accepted Islam, they would embrace Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on one hand, some of his people are gone to Abyssinia. The other hand, people in Makkatul Mukarramah are being persecuted. And now what is happening? He takes Zayd ibn Haritha, who was the closest person to him as well now, and he walks to At-Taif. They went on foot. Why did they go on foot? Because had they gone on horseback, camelback, people would know these people are now leaving Makkah. They would get excited. They wouldn't allow them to go because they would want him back. They did not want Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go elsewhere, because as much as they didn't like him, they knew that people from outside were coming and accepting the message. They knew it. So they were confused, these people of Quraysh. One hand they say, we're going to expel him. On another hand they say, no, we're going to keep him here and ground him. We don't want anyone to talk to him. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Taif. When he went to Taif, he immediately headed for the leaders of Taif. Who were they? Abd Yalil, that was one, Ibn Amr, and his two brothers, Mas'ud ibn Amr and Habib ibn Amr. These were the three people. He went to them, he spoke to them, he presented Islam to them. It is reported that in total he was 10 days in Taif. And he presented Islam to them in a beautiful way. And he told them about Allah and about the idols and about good character and conduct and not burying the girls alive and not engaging in misbehavior and misconduct and cheating and deceiving and waylaying and being, you know, robbing the traveler and so on. And he told them also of Quraysh and their persecution. Now these people, they did not accept the message, number one. Number two is, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, okay, if you don't want to accept the message, no problem, but please do me one favor, don't tell Quraysh that I was here, because if they know that I am seeking protection and I am seeking your assistance to go and fight them, then there is going to be a lot of trouble. What did they do? They sent a messenger straight to Quraysh. This man, he came to us and he is trying to win our support against you. The reason is the two of them had their squabbles. Now, in order to settle it a little bit, they quickly went to tell, to say, you know what, this man here is a middleman here and we are going to deal with him. And in the meantime, these three, instead of sending him away respectfully to say, look, we don't accept your message, they sent the children and the slaves, boys and girls, out on the streets and told them, stone this man and mock at him and do whatever you want to him and nothing will happen to you. We are the leaders. We're going to sit here and watch. A'udhu billah. So as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taken a message of peace and goodness to the people of Taif, they retaliated with stones and sticks. They threw stones, they hurled abuse, they made him bleed. He was harmed and he was hurt on his body, and the blood was now trickling in his shoes. His shoes were filled, and he is going out of Taif, and they are running behind him, and they are pelting him, and they are laughing at him as though they were pelting a dog. A'udhu billah. May Allah safeguard us. And this is the best of creation who came to them with a message of goodness. These were the people of Thaqif. And what had happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A few pointers of mercy. One is, he says, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have watched what they have done to you. We know what they have done to you. You instruct us, we will do to them what you wish. Then it is reported, according to one narration, although some of the scholars of hadith say that this narration is mursal. Mursal meaning the chain is not complete near the end. So there was a man known as Addas. He was a slave of Utbah and Shayba ibn Rabi'ah, and they had had a little garden in Taif, on the outskirts of Taif. So as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was running out, he found a little shrubbery where the grapes were growing. So he ducked underneath it, him and Zayd ibn Haritha. And he noticed when he looked up that it was a very hot day, but the cloud was covering him. Subhanallah. Imagine a hot day, enemies from all over, but the clouds are not your enemies. The creatures of Allah besides man, not your enemies. And this particular group of people, they were cursed. Imagine those hands that were pelting Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam personally, far worse than those hands that draw cartoons today, although both of them are equal in blaspheme. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So Utbah and Shayba ibn Rabi'ah, the two sons of Rabi'ah, they saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and these people are from Quraysh. They had their garden in Taif, and they looked and they saw this man in blood bleeding, and they saw that he is helpless, no water, no drink, no food. So it is reported, according to this narration that I have just made mention of, which is Mursal, it is reported that they sent Addas, the slave of theirs, they sent him with some grapes. Go and give that man. Just give it to him and come back. So when Addas went there, he gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the grapes, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Bismillah. As he said Bismillah, Addas looks at him and says, what did you say? Whatever you've said now, the people here don't even say that. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, obviously I said in the name of Allah, and I'm eating in the name of Allah. Where are you from and who are you? He says, I am Addas, and I come from Ninwa, which is in Iraq. And there, so before he could utter more, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that is the place where Yunus ibn Matta, Yunus, the son of Matthew, is from Yunus alayhi salatu was salam. So Adas was shocked. How do you know? How do you know? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam read some verses of the Quran where the story of Yunus is made mention. This Adas, it is reported, started kissing the forehead of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he declared, you're a messenger. You're a messenger. This is the one person who accepted Islam as he was leaving Taif. And now Utbah and Shaybah, the sons of Rabi'ah, are watching this Adas. And when he came back, what's your problem? How can you kiss that man? And he is a man whom you don't even know. What did he tell you? So he said, look, he told me something that only a prophet can know. That's it. They said, be careful of this man. And the narration ends there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. It is amana that I narrate to you or relate to you that narration is mursal, which means the chain of narration of narrators is not exactly complete. But most of the books of history have made mention of the story of Adas. So it's important for us to make mention of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who realize the true value of being Muslim. Wallahi, a great sacrifice has gone in getting this message across to us and to the globe. But this was all by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then left Taif. And as he came back on his feet, he was walking. He stopped at a place called Wadi Nakhla for a few days. And he used to read Quran in the night in Salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him later on that when you were in that valley of Nakhla, a group of jinn, approximately 7 of the jinn, had come and they heard you recite the Quran. And Allah sent revelation to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling him the following.
وَإِذْ صَرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفَرًا مِّنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ فَلَمَّا حَضَرُوهُ قَالُوا أَنْصِتُوا فَلَمَّا قُضِيَ وَلَّوْا إِلَى قَوْمِهِمْ مُنذِرِينَ قَالُوا يَا قَوْمَنَا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا كِتَابًا أُنْزِلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى مصدقا لما بين يديه يهدي إلى الحق وإلى طريق مستقيم يا قومنا أجيبوا داعي الله وآمنوا به.
الله أكبر. I will stop there. Powerful verses. Allah says, we had made the jinn come to you and listen to the Quran. When they heard it, they attended and they said to each other, stop in silence and listen to what is being recited. When they heard it, they immediately felt and they knew that this is the guidance. They believed in it, rushed back to their people, meaning to jinn kind, and told them, oh, our jinn kind, we have just heard revelation after Moses, which is similar to that which he has brought, and it is true, and there is a messenger reciting it. Believe in what he has brought, and indeed you will be forgiven. The jinn kind are saying this. So Allah says, hang on, the jinn have believed. If the people of Taif told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to leave, and they harmed him, these were jinn, and they had accepted the message. But there is one thing that we need to know before this incident of the jinn. And that is, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is leaving Taif, I made mention of Jibreel coming to him and telling him, you tell us, what do you want? The angels of the mountains, they came to him and told him, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these people between these two mountains, you tell us, we will crush them now. You just tell us, give us the instruction, and we will deal with them. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he raises his hands. He says, Allahumma inni ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati wa qillata hilati wa hawani ala nas. Oh Allah, oh Allah, I am complaining to you. About what? About people? About these people of Taif? We can destroy them. No, I am complaining to you about my weakness. Ya Allah, I am weak. You sent me to Taif. I went to Taif, they didn't even listen. In Quraysh, they're not even listening. A handful of people. Ya Allah, this is happening. Ya Allah, I'm complaining to you about my weakness and how weak I am. Subhanallah. And when this powerful messenger makes such a merciful remark, looking at his weakness rather than the weakness of the others. Not even weakness, the sin of the others. War crimes, literally, of the others. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, it's me who's weak. No, no, no. Then he says, Allahumma hdi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. What I want from you now, Ya Allah, guide these people. Guide my people because they don't know what they're doing. So the angel says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can destroy them at that juncture. Do you know what he says? He says, leave them. Perhaps Allah will take out from their progeny people who will accept my message. Imagine, look at how he is thinking of the future, praying for the future, having hope for the future. And he is saying, perhaps from their progeny, there will be people who will accept my message. Later on, you see how Thaqif accepted Islam. Subhanallah. Today you go to Taif. Who is there? Not a single non-Muslim. All the people of Taif are Muslim. Imagine if sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad ibn Abdullah had to say, destroy them. Today there would be ruins in Taif. We would see the ruins. People will probably go there and make a tourist site out of it. And this is the weakness with us. We see the ruins of the previous nations. We convert them into a tourist resort, not thinking that we are actually supposed to be learning a lesson from whatever has happened. You can go, but on condition that you're learning a lesson and it's drawing you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now returned, we made mention of what happened with the jinn. And as he's going into Makkah, they didn't want him in Makkah. He couldn't enter because now he was out. They didn't want him back in. They wanted to fight him and kill him because he went to seek assistance from others against Quraysh. So at that juncture, he goes to Al-Mut'im ibn Adi and he says, look, I need you to guarantee for me, or I need you to stand as guarantee for me so that I can enter into Quraysh. And as we said yesterday, this was the norm at the time. They used to give guarantees for one another on certain grounds. This man, I guarantee, and so on, and please let him in. So Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, his children got up with him, and it's reported some of his family members got up with him. They took their swords and they took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam right to the Kaaba and allowed them to make tawaf around it. And the people of Quraysh are looking and saying, are you just following or is he under your guarantee? He says, he's under my guarantee. Subhanallah. Then they were quiet. They said, if that's the case, we leave him alone. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really had suffered at the hands of Quraysh directly and indirectly. There was another incident that occurred also, which was of great blessing. One man from Daws. Daws was a tribe that was not so far. The people of Daws, just one man had come, At-Tufail ibn Amr. At-Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi had come to see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca. And he saw him. And immediately he accepted. He said, yes, this is the messenger. I believe and I bear witness. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him some good news, read some Quran for him, and told him, go back to your people, invite them to Islam. I'm making a dua. Allahumma hdi dawsa. Oh Allah, guide the people of Daws. When this At-Tufail ibn Amr went back to Daws, he conveyed the message, and the majority of them turned to Islam. The majority of them turned to Islam. Do you know who is from Daws? For your information, a man who has narrated the most hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His name is Abdurrahman ibn Sakhr, more commonly known as Abu Hurairah. Today we quoted him also in our talk, Abu Hurairah. His proper name is Abdurrahman ibn Sakhr. As we mentioned Abu Bakr, his proper name is Abdullah ibn Uthman. So here you have Abdurrahman ibn Sakhr. Abu Hurairah, he was a Dawsi. And he had also accepted Islam. And later on, he met with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors and to grant us goodness. Now we have a very, very important incident that occurred at the time for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for the Muslims. Remember, this 10th year of Hijrah was known as Amul Huzn. It was known, the 10th year of prophethood, not Hijrah. I think if I've said Hijrah, what I mean here is prophethood. Because as you know, there at that time, they used to use some big incident that occurred, and they used to count a year before it, a year after it, like we said, the year of the elephants. The next most important thing that happened was the year of prophethood. And the next most important thing was the year of Hijrah, and up to today, that was one of the most important things that occurred. So we say Hijri calendar, the calendar of Hijrah. And we are sitting today at 1433 years from that Hijrah. So what had happened is, it was a year of sadness, the 10th year of prophethood. He lost his uncle, he lost his wife. He went to Ta'if and he was beaten and he was literally booted out, and he came back from Ta'if and now he was in Mecca. And as a gift, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the 11th year of Nubuwa, granted him what is known as Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, the journey by night and the ascension. And this, when did it happen? What was the date? The truth is, there is no authentic narration giving us the precise date. So if someone says, oh, it is this date or that date, the reality is, that is not an authentic narration. The bulk of the muhaddithin say it happened in the month of Ramadan. Some of them say it happened towards the end of Rajab. Whatever be the case, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a lesson from that mi'raj. There's no point in debating this and that. We need to look at what is not debated. The issue of Isra and Mi'raj is not debated. So why debate about a little issue of the date? Let the date be something which is irrelevant for now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the lesson. So one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to sleep at the house of his cousin Ummu Hani, and as he was sleeping there, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam comes to him with a buraq. And one narration says he was in the Hijr. The Hijr meaning the Hatim. You know the Hatim area in the vicinity of the Kaaba. In fact, it is part of the Kaaba. We made mention of it, the semicircular. Now, both narrations are correct because he was there and then he was brought here. So this is what happened. So he was at the house of Hani and he was brought to where the well of Zamzam was. And when he was brought there, subhanallah, something massive happened, something huge happened. The occasion of the journey by night from Mecca all the way to Jerusalem, and from Jerusalem he was taken in Mi'raj. The meaning of Mi'raj, Mi'raj means an elevator. An elevator, that's the meaning of Mi'raj. So the Buraq's job was to take him from Mecca to Jerusalem. And from Jerusalem, Mi'raj, the elevator took him all the way up with Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And how did he go up? He went up physically, in body and soul, according to Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, subhanallah. You know, people, inshallah, we will talk in detail about this tomorrow, but sometimes people say, how could he have gone up in such a short while? And how could he have gone up? Believe me, today we have rockets that take you into orbit within 1.5 minutes. 1.5 minutes you are in orbit, they tell you that. What is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They say, how could he have gone all the way to Jerusalem from Mecca in such a short space of time? Well, you have the Concorde that goes faster than 330 meters per second. That's the speed of sound. It breaks the sound barrier and it takes you. In fact, there is a bullet that travels even faster than that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us lesson. Tomorrow, inshallah, we'll commence with this story of Isra and Mi'raj. Until we meet again, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdih. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Alif Lam Mim. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum.